it's all about finding new solutions for problems that farmers have, helping them grow their products, their crops better. We're looking for new solutions around managing or controlling weeds. And weeds are extremely competitive to their crop. Looking for new chemistry solutions, but also integrating that with cultural control techniques and a whole host of different things that we're trying to optimize, either looking for new products, new chemistry tools with effective modes of action that control the weed, but also are minimizing effects on the environment.
From planting to harvest, controlling weeds is likely a farmer's number one challenge. Yes, insects and drought and storms all create serious problems for farmers, but it's weeds that are consistently a farmer's number one challenge. That's because almost half of a farmer's crop will be lost without weed control. Here's why.
So this is about 1 week or 2 weeks?
This is 1 week after planting.
Okay, and this is 1 week of?
Of cotton.
And this is 1 week of?
Of soybean.
Okay.
And at this point, you would say, maybe it's not so bad. You know, the cotton and the soybean, they're larger, they'd be able to compete, okay? So 6 weeks later. Now, if it had to compete with the Palmer amaranth, you're looking at a situation like this, and most of the green here is the Palmer amaranth plant, and the soybean's here, and you can see how much smaller the soybean plant is compared without the weed.
This is the weed.
This is the weed. This is the Palmer amaranth.
After 6 weeks.
Yeah.
And this was after 1 week.
Yeah, one to 6 weeks.
All right. So explain. So what happened?
Its dynamic ability to compete, you know, really fight for nutrients, light, and moisture with that crop plant. And in fact, it's interesting. If your crop grows taller, the amaranth, the Palmer amaranth, will grow taller as well. It gets just tall enough to be able to overwhelm the crop plant. And in fact, you know, research has shown that to really eliminate this competition, you have to control the amaranth before the soybean is 2 to 3 leaf. Mm-hmm. So just beyond this stage, if you don't have control of your amaranth, you're going to start to suffer yield and economic loss.
And that's why researchers at BASF spend a lot of time thinking about weeds and weed control. From the size and the shape of the drop of the herbicide to the molecules that make up the chemicals. And all that thinking starts with soil.
Some of these drier, richer iron type soils, high pHs, low pH soils, high organic matter, low organic matter.
The United States has 32 different types of soil.
Even here in North Carolina, as you start in the coast, you have a very sandy type soil. You move into the Piedmont, you're starting to get a little more clay. You pick up a little more iron, it starts to get a little redder. Then you move up into the mountains, and it changes again. The organic matter can affect the amount of herbicide that's going to be needed. The herbicide tends to bind to very high organic matter soils versus the ones that are very low. It tends to move a little further. And what we want to make sure is that that herbicide is kept in the layer where it's going to prevent your weeds, but not get either too far down and impact where the crop is trying to grow, or in a worst case scenario, it's actually going as far as groundwater. So by testing it across these different soil types, we understand how far it'll move in a sand type soil versus a clay type soil, and we adjust the application rates accordingly.
For us, we could be trying to simulate low volume applications, something like a grower in Kansas growing wheat, or even a higher volume application in something like a golf course.
Then there's the question of how best to apply the herbicide.
So with the spray chamber, we can take out and adjust different settings. So we can change our nozzle, change our speed, change our pressure, whatever we're trying to mimic that's going on in the field. So then we put those plants in the greenhouse, the growth chamber, whatever environment we're trying to simulate, just to see how those products are going to work. Sometimes we only monitor those plants for a couple days. Sometimes it's a few weeks. Sometimes it's a few months. It just depends on the mode of action, how fast it's going to work, and what we can expect out of it.
I would imagine then also then you can look at the plant and see how it applied.
Yes.
Right? So how do we do? So if you take a look at it, it was a pretty wide general spray, it looked like.
Yes, we were spraying a pretty high volume right here, so you can actually see the droplets, and you see the waxy leaf of this Palmer amaranth. You see how the water beaded up on that leaf surface. Compared to the velvet leaf, you see it actually spread out a little more. And so you see it running down the mid vein and through the other architecture in that leaf. You can also use water-sensitive paper. So this water-sensitive paper has special dyes that when water comes in contact with it, you can see exactly where those droplets hit and what size those droplets are.
The goal is for a farmer to use just enough chemical to do what is needed. Too much chemical hurts the environment and the farmer's wallet.
We actually spend about 10 years researching a product before it goes to market. And a lot of that time is spent figuring out how it can be used most effectively, but also identifying the safety of the product. We don't want to bring anything to market that isn't safe for the environment and for people.